Hello everyone, welcome to today's webinar. Hope you guys can see my screen and hear me loud and clear. Thank you Mohammed, thank you Ravi. So guys, let's just wait a minute and then we'll start the webinar. Hey guys, so today's webinar guys agenda is Ansible. Ansible is a configuration management tool. Okay, so in today's webinar we will understand first what is configuration management, how our IT infrastructure management completely changes after using configuration management tool, what is Ansible, different features of Ansible. We'll see how global organizations like NASA are using Ansible to maintain their infrastructure. We'll see how Ansible is used for orchestration, for provisioning, configuration management. And lastly, we'll see how to set up Ansible and try to run some Ansible playbooks to set up our environment like Tomcat application, something like that. Okay, so let's talk about configuration management. So to explain why we need configuration management guys, let's take a scenario. So guys, till now most of you would have written code either for development purpose or for testing purpose. I'm pretty sure hardly any one of you have written code to manage your infrastructure. But going forward, when we work on configuration management tool, we use something called infrastructure as a code. It's called as IAC, where we write code to manage and provision our environment. That is what configuration management tool helps us with. Now take a scenario guys, let's say I have got 100 servers. Okay, out of these 100 servers I have got, let's say, 70 Unix servers and 30 Windows servers. Now I have been given the task of deploying Java on all these 100 servers. So how I will do is, I have got two approaches. First, I can manually log into each of these 100 servers and install the Java. But with this manual approach, it will be so much time taking. It can be error prone. We need so much manpower. We have all those challenges. Second approach, what I can do traditionally is, I can write a shell script or Python script for Linux servers. I can write a PowerShell or Bash script for Windows servers. The script need to written from scratch, from very basic, try to run the code and deploy our Java application on these 100 servers. But again, you will need experts who have programming knowledge, in-depth knowledge, both on shell, PowerShell, Bash, Python, like multiple operating systems sort of thing. So it is not easy. Again, writing code from scratch is not at all easy and it takes a lot of time and energy. What if I'm able to use a configuration management tool like Ansible, where using just two lines of code, I can deploy my application, so let's say for Java in this scenario, across multiple servers irrespective of their OS. So using configuration management tool with just two lines of code, we can deploy our application across all these servers, whether they are CentOS, Ubuntu, RHEL, Windows, does not matter. That is the beauty of configuration management tool. Let's take one more example guys. So in any organization, you have got multiple life cycles, right? You have got a dev life cycle, you have got a QA life cycle, you have got a prod life cycle, for example. Now, you have been asked to maintain consistency of deployment across all these life cycles. So when I say that, let's say for example, if Java, let's say 2.0 is running on dev, Java 2.0 should be running on QA, and Java 2.0 should be running on prod. How will you do that? It's very, very difficult. Generally, what happens in an organization you see is, while testing or while doing some pre-deployment checks and all, we update the application version in dev and QA. But generally the prod version, we never try to touch or upgrade because we fear it may break things. Now, a developer written an application, which is let's say dependent on Java 2.0. That application will work for successfully in dev and QA. But by the time it comes for deployment to prod, because of this version mismatch or infra complications, it may not work in prod. So how to solve this problem? So guys, all these scenarios can be solved by configuration management tool. If you're working for any Fortune 500 company where you've got thousands and thousands of servers, and if you're an admin or a guy who takes care of server provisioning or administration management, configuration management can help you to ease your life like anything. You can do any sort of thing with user administration using configuration management tool, like deploying a software, starting a service, creating a user, changing the permissions, enforcing security policies, you name a thing, all those things are possible using configuration management tools. And here in particular, we're talking about Ansible as our principal configuration management. So I just explained the example of why do we need a configuration management tool. It definitely helps us to maintain servers irrespective of the scenario, operating system, what type it is. It can easily manage using the configuration management tool. Same thing as explained here. Because if you have to configure server, provision servers, all those things take a lot of time. But with configuration management tool, we can easily provision and manage our infrastructure so that the people like tester, developers, they can quickly test the environment, developers can deploy their application. Guys, one more the good thing about configuration management tool here is, let's say you deployed Java 2.0, same thing, to all your 100 servers. Now, let's say this Java 2.0 did not look as good as it should have been in your application, and a lot of application break. Now, you need to do a rollback. That means, let's say you want to move from 2.0 to 1.8. How will you do it manually? Very, very difficult. You have to write first script, uninstall Java 2.0, then again deploy 1.8. It's a tedious task. And it may go for a restart, all those things. But with configuration management tool, with one line of code, we can simply do a rollback. So that is another good thing we have with the configuration management tool, rollups and rollbacks. Now guys, there are in principle, four famous configuration management tools. We have got Puppet, we have got Ansible, we have got Chef, and we have got Salt. Ansible by far is the most famous and most popular tool in this category of configuration management, followed by Puppet, followed by Chef, and Salt is literally new to this industry, and very few companies are currently using Salt as their principal configuration management tool. Now, what's the difference among all these tools? So guys, Puppet follows pull methodology. Ansible follows push methodology. Chef again follows pull methodology. And Salt follows push methodology. Now, what's the difference between pull and push? You guys must be wondering. So let's talk on that. So guys, one of the reasons why Ansible is gaining so much popularity or used so much globally is Ansible is an agentless tool. When I say agentless, Ansible follows a master-slave configuration. Okay, like you have a main server, which you call as controller node, where you push your configuration, and using the controller, the configuration deployed to different servers or nodes connected to it. So here in Ansible architecture, the agent is only deployed at the controller level. We don't deploy any agent on the individual nodes connected to it. While in comparison to agent like Puppet, which follows pull methodology, it's an agent-based architecture. That means you have one agent for the master node or the controller node, and you have another agent at all the slave nodes that are connected to it. Now, since this Puppet has agents both at the controller and at the slave node, in this architecture, it is always the responsibility of the slave nodes to start communication with the master node. That means these different nodes which are connected to this master node in the Puppet will start the communication from the master node. Since they start the communication, they try to pull the configuration or the latest configuration that need to be applied from the controller to the slave node. That is why it is called as pull configuration, because here the slave nodes are pulling the configuration from the slave master to the slaves. While in case of Ansible, since it's agentless and we don't have any agent installed at different slave nodes connected to it, the controller pushes the configuration to different servers or nodes connected to it. That's why it is called as push configuration. So guys, clear everyone, what is push configuration and pull configuration? Anyone, any doubts? So Ravi, as I was explaining, in push configuration, take example of Ansible, it is agentless, okay? We don't have any agent deployed on the slave nodes connected to it. So the master node or the controller node pushes the configuration to different nodes connected to it. That's why it's called as push configuration. While in terms of Puppet pull configuration, it's an agent based. That means you have the agent both at the controller and at the slave node. And in this architecture,
it is always the responsibility of slave nodes to pull the configuration from the master nodes. That is why it is called as pull architecture. So Shri, you can configure it manually. By default, it is 30 minutes in the pull architecture. Okay, but you have all the option to change it as per your requirement. You can make it 1 minute, 5 minutes. You have options for a lot of them. So see guys, Ashok is asking the pros and cons. See Ashok, any agent-based architecture comes with its own baggage. You need to make sure the agent is always healthy, which is not an easy task. So let's say you are using Puppet on 1,000 servers as your principal configuration management tool. You need to make sure that all the 1,000 servers Puppet agent is healthy. So that is comes with its own baggage, right? So it is not easy to do that. But the good thing of agent-based architecture is scalability is easy. The moment you deploy agent, your infra is set up. So everything comes with its own baggage and own pros and cons, Ashok. Clear everyone, guys? Okay, let's proceed. So guys, let's talk more about Ansible. So let's talk about Ansible architecture. Okay, so guys, as I told you, Ansible is a configuration management tool. It's a push-based methodology configuration management tool. It helps us to automate our infrastructure provisioning and infrastructure management. So as some things we discussed some time back. Now let's talk about Ansible architecture. Like what are different components of Ansible architecture and how they play out. We'll do that, Shri. Hold on, please. So guys, in Ansible, we have three principal components. One is inventory, one is playbook and module. Let's see how they works up. So the first component here is inventory. And then we have something called playbooks. And then we have something called module. These things are connected to something called Ansible config. So guys, Ansible controller can only be installed on a Linux operating system. When I say Linux operating system, it can be a CentOS machine, it can be Ubuntu machine, it can be a RHEL machine. Another thing is you need to have Python framework present. That is why, because on Windows machine, you don't have Python framework present. So to install controller, you need a machine with Python framework. That is why it is a Linux dependent machine. And then it gets connected to different nodes. Okay, so now let's talk about all these components. So guys, first let's talk about modules. Okay, so modules are like the command center of for Ansible. Okay, through modules only we perform tasks like installation, configuration on remote machine. So whenever we install Ansible, by default some 2000 modules gets downloaded. Okay, these modules are developed by the Ansible community or the Ansible developers. So any task you want to install, let's say I want to find uptime of a server. So for that, I will be using a module called command. Let's say I want to ping another server to check it's pingable or not. For that, I will be using a module called ping. So like this, we have got 2000 plus modules in our Ansible architecture. Another component is inventory. So let's take example, guys. I have got 60 servers in my infrastructure, for example, and I want to only push my code or my application, whatever my scenario is, only 20 servers. How do I do that? So inventory is a location where we list our servers or group our servers which are to be configured. Okay, so let's say I want to push my configuration only to these 20 servers. I'll make a group, give my group any name, let's say test, and inside this group I will give the list of 20 servers where my configuration to be applied. So when I run my playbook, it will only target this group, test group, so that my configuration get only pushed to these 20 servers. That is the beauty of inventory. You can create as many group as you want for Ansible. Yes, Shri, modules are predefined. Then guys, we have another component called playbooks. So guys, playbooks are a YAML file which are written by user. You can say this way, playbooks are a glue which connects inventory and module. So let's say if you want to apply some configuration on some servers, you need to call a module and define which particular servers you want that to be applied on. So basically playbook is that piece of code, or you can a glue, which basically connects your inventory and module. Then guys, you've got Ansible config. It is the file where global settings are stored, like location of the inventory, module, and all those things. So that is about Ansible config, guys. So guys, as I mentioned you, one prerequisite is Ansible should be installed on your controller node or your master node. By default, it comes installed on all Linux machine. So this was about guys Ansible architecture. So to communicate between this master and slave node, Ansible use SSH, okay, the public private key sharing. So we establish authentication using SSH. That is how Ansible works, guys. So guys, this was in brief about Ansible architecture. What is Ansible architecture and how it communicate between master and slave node. Now guys, why is Ansible being so much popular, or what are different features of Ansible? Firstly, as I told you, it's agentless. That is a big add-on, because we compare to other configuration management tool like Puppet or Chef, they're agent-based. So they comes with their own baggage, while Ansible is an agentless tool. Another good thing about Ansible, guys, is it is very, very simple to administer and manage. Okay. It's very, very simple to install, very easy to learn. We'll set up Ansible after this PPT and you'll see how easy it is to set up Ansible. It is very, very powerful. Almost all your IT tasks, I have not seen a single IT task, a single IT requirement which cannot be completed using Ansible. It is very powerful. It has got modules to suffice to all your requirements and needs. So that is the beauty about Ansible. Second, another thing is in Ansible, you can write modules in any programming language. The base structure of Ansible uses YAML, which stands for Ain't Another Markup Language. It's a deserialization like language like JSON, but your modules can be created in any programming language. That is the beauty about Ansible. So guys, this was in brief about Ansible. Guys, one second, my marker is not coming up. So guys, clear so far? Anyone, any doubts, any questions? Okay. So guys, let's talk about a case study where how organizations using NASA globally, sorry, using Ansible, are saving time and making their life easy. So guys, NASA, National Aeronautics Space Administration, the US Space Agency, wanted to move the SIP 65 applications from traditional hardware servers to cloud-based environment. Okay. At the same time, when they want to migrate it, they want to save some cost. They did not want it to have SSH cost. Okay, this migration cost. They wanted to have more security and better agility. So Ravi, you no need to buy certificates for SSH. It can be done in free. I will show you. Okay, how did NASA achieve this goal? So NASA, for this particular problems, using Ansible as their one-stop shop to do migration with more security, with better access rights, and with more agility. Okay, so NASA uses AWS cloud, guys, with multiple VPCs. Okay, as you can see, when NASA moved into the cloud, they had these many problems. They were scattered, okay, no agility, no process, no security. But they were actually aiming for a structured approach where they everything grouped properly, every credentials grouped properly, proper RBAC model, proper playbook, proper templates. Okay, so how these things can problems can be solved, guys? See, for these things we create playbooks, guys. See, in playbooks, NASA, if NASA would have used playbooks, guys, it would have made life so easy for them. They could define like which host to move to what architecture, which host to move to what group, all those things. So that is the beauty about Ansible. You can literally group on what servers, what permission need to be applied. If you compare to other configuration management tool like Puppet or Chef, grouping is not so easy. While in Ansible, grouping is so easy. We have a file location, which is called inventory file. And inside the inventory file, you can define a list of servers where you want your configuration to be applied or configuration to be pushed to. Now guys, Ansible is mainly a GUI based tool. That means you have to write playbooks in your command prompt or command line and then execute it. But Ansible comes in a GUI flavor also, which is called as Ansible Tower. The only challenge here is Ansible Tower don't come as free version. To use Ansible Tower, you need to have licensing. While to use Ansible over the CLI, traditionally using playbooks and all, you don't need any licensing. But for using Ansible Tower, you need licensing, which comes at a steep cost. But the beauty about Ansible Tower is, with Ansible Tower, management becomes so easy. It is like a typical GUI based tool. They're using some clicks. You can do some deployment, provisioning, management, administration, all those things. So if you're working for any organization which uses Ansible or is planning to use Ansible, then probably your organization will go for Ansible Tower licensing. With that, Ansible management, administration, usage, all becomes very, very easy. So guys, this is how typically your Ansible Tower looks like. In Ansible Tower only, you can define all your properties, like which host you want the config to be applied to, what credentials to be used, what organization, what project, all those things. That is the beauty about Ansible Tower. Okay, so guys, what's the advantage of using Ansible? What benefit NASA noticed? Okay, to apply updates, it used to previously take them 1 hour, which is now down to 5 minutes. Okay, to apply patches, patching is a weekly activity, monthly activity, and I think on all the companies you guys work, you have a patching team which apply patches. Your patches process went down from multi-day process for NASA to just 45 minutes a day. Application stack time reduced from an hour or so to just 10 minutes a day. You are almost having near real-time monitoring. That is another beauty of Ansible, guys. So these are some of the typical advantage or results benefits which NASA had after using Ansible as their configuration management tool. So guys, Ansible architecture, we already talked about. This was a brief about Ansible architecture, how Ansible architecture works, how different things communicate to it. Ravi, depends what patches you want to apply. You can apply whatever patch you want, whether application level patch or OS level patch. It's completely a user based scenario. So guys, we already spoke about Ansible architecture, playbooks, inventory modules. So same thing explained here. Same time, guys, you can Ansible has got plugins for. Let's say you want to integrate Ansible with Jenkins, another CI tool. So you've got plugin for it. You want to integrate Ansible with Bamboo. You have a plugin for it. So Ansible has got different plugins available for different requirements. Let's say you want to use Ansible with Azure. Okay. Then you have plugin for that. So they have different plugin available for different scenario. See Ravi, when you say about testing, okay, that's why we talked about in any organization, you've got different life cycle servers like dev, QA, prod. So obviously before applying to prod, you will apply your servers, your testing servers to your dev servers, right? That is what testing will come there. So Deepti and Naveen, CMDB stands for Configuration Management Database. A centralized location where you store details about all your servers or in your infrastructure. You would have heard of terms like ServiceNow CMDB, okay, all those things. So in Ansible, you do have an option, but it is not recommended that you can pull all your infrastructure details at once from CMDB. The problem with this happens here is if you do a CMDB integration is whatever configuration you try to apply gets applied to all the servers of your infrastructure, which most of the times we don't want to do. So that is why this particular CMDB integration is not recommended while using Ansible, but it is a feature. It can be any database, sir, an external Mongo, Postgres, anything. So guys, as I told you, in Ansible we use something called YAML. YAML stands for Int Another Markup Language. Inside of playbook, we do all our declarations, like which server you want the configuration to be pushed, what configuration you want to push to is. We use a word called task here in Ansible. That means what tasks need to be applied on different scenarios. Yes, Ravi, you can do logging also with Metric, with Ansible. That is very, very true. So as you can see, guys, a controller machine from where we'll write a playbook, and the playbook will deploy the code to different slave nodes or agents connected to it. So guys, typical example of playbook we'll see in the lab once we do it. You see here in this playbook, we are making sure that we install Apache 2. Okay, and we're trying to install the latest version of Apache. A simple playbook being shown here. Mohammed, YAML stands for Ain't Another Markup Language. It's a deserialization language like JSON and XML. Now guys, how to use Ansible? Okay, so guys, Ansible can be used for deploying an application. You can install the application, you can do a service, install a start a service, you can do orchestration. You want to do some auto scaling, all those things that can be done using Ansible. You can do a management. Let's say you want to have in, make sure that the same version of application runs across multiple servers of your environment. All those things are possible using Ansible. Then provisioning. Even you can provision your infrastructure in any cloud enterprise or bare metal using Ansible. So these are some of the typical uses where Ansible is used for. So guys, let's talk about orchestration. A simple example given here. I want to install certain application like, let's say, HTTP, HTML, PHP file, get data from MySQL database and run it on my servers. A simple scenario like to deploy an application, which can easily be achieved or done using Ansible as your configuration management tool. Don't worry, you'll see it in the lab. You just want to cover theoretical portions first. So guys, Ansible works with almost all the cloud provision environment, whether it's Google, Azure, AWS. You can provision infrastructure there, do testing, deploy applications, all those things using Ansible as a configuration management tool. Ansible also works if you have a hybrid environment. That means some of your applications running on-premise and some of the applications on the cloud. In that scenario also, Ansible is very, very helpful. You can deploy your controller either in the on-premise or cloud, and from sitting at one location, you can manage both your infrastructure, both on-premise and cloud infrastructure. Now guys, another same example explained here. If you want to apply some updates on one set of server and another set of server. So as I informed you guys, using inventory, we can do this. At inventory, we group our servers or define the list where you want application to be applied, and that way we can do that. So Mohammed Akash, as I explained in the diagram, orchestration like deploying your code, doing auto provisioning, all those things. So that can be done using Ansible. So guys, here in this diagram, you see a typical DevOps pipeline or lifecycle has been explained, where a developer writes a code. The code is fit to a version control system like Git. Then using Jenkins, the code is compiled in packages, then finally deployed to a test server, and then deployed to a prod server. So every stage of this lifecycle can be integrated with Ansible using plugins. So as I told you, Ansible has got plugins for different scenarios and requirements. So it has got plugin for Jenkins, it has got plugin to communicate to dev environment servers, prod servers, to Git, so that all those things can be done using plugins. And you can automate your infrastructure provisioning and management. Now guys, let's talk about security. Someone asked me about patching, right? So guys, the beauty about Ansible is Microsoft every second Tuesday of the month releases updates. Okay, you can write a playbook which runs only on every second Tuesday, get the latest security patches from the Microsoft side, and then apply it to all the different Windows nodes connected to it. Same way Linux releases patches every third Tuesday or fourth Tuesday, I forget the exact date. You can write a playbook which runs only on the third or fourth Tuesday, gets all the latest patches and apply to all your Linux environment servers. That way you can define your playbooks which can do all those tasks. If you have some third-party tools for security in your organization, even Ansible can be compatible with that also. You can use Ansible for security verification, for RBAC model, for SSH, for WinRM, all those things Ansible can be used for. So Akash, SSH is referred for public private key sharing. Okay, it is a way using which we communicate or establish trust among Linux servers. if you ask in terms of abbreviation, it stands for secure shell or secure socket shell, whatever you can call it. So let's try Ansible some hands-on. Okay, so let's try some Ansible hands-on and then we'll come to other parts of a slide. So to use Ansible, as I told you, we need a master slave architecture, right? That is how Ansible works. So I'm going to spin up two machines. One machine is going to act as my Ansible controller and another machine is going to act as my Ansible slave node. So let's create two machines, guys. Okay, we'll ask it to use CentOS. You can select any OS, Central, Ubuntu, up to you guys. Let's create one more machine. Ansible slave. What's the name? Again, I will make it CentOS. So guys, this is my controller machine. As I told you in starting, Ansible is an agentless tool. That means you only install the Ansible agent on the controller node. So how to install it? Yum install dash y Ansible. Simple one line command to install Ansible on your controller node. Now let's start the Ansible service. So first check the Ansible service status. Service Ansible status. Okay, no need to start Ansible service. Now guys, another thing I told you is Ansible follows public private key sharing or SSH to communicate to master and slave nodes. Okay, so Deepthi, for that you have to use Kerberos. Okay, so how to do that? So guys, I'm not going to run any of my command as root, since root is the most. What I'm going to do is I'm going to make a small change. Okay, vi. So by default, password authentication is not enabled on the cloud servers. Since I'm using cloud machine, you can use your own machine. There, password authentication will be enabled. So vi sshd underscore config. Escape insert. Service I'm going to create a user. Let's say Kushag. I'm going to create some password for this user. Okay, now any task I perform with this user. Because generally, guys, you would have noticed in your corporate, you don't get root rights on all the servers, right? So we should be doing a similar type of environment. I'll do the same exercise on the slave node. The difference is I no need to install the Ansible service here. Since the Ansible need to be only start on the master node, what I will do is I will just create the same username here. The password can be different and we'll see things how it goes from there. This step is not needed, guys, if you're using Azure VM or your on-premise. Since I'm using Google VM, there you have to use this step. Otherwise, not needed to enable password authentication. Okay, so I made a new user, Kushag, and I gave some password to it. You can create whatever user you want for your choice. So Naveen, master node no need to have config keys for all the servers. Master node will push its keys to the other servers. Okay, so now let's go to master node. How to generate the key? Simple one line command, ssh-keygen. You no need to get any certificate, anything like this, okay? Just press enter. I want a default file. I don't want any passphrase. My public private key got created. Simple one line command. Okay. Now I need to share this public key to all the different nodes where I want to configure my Ansible infrastructure. So how to do that? ssh-copy-id-i. Okay. Give which username. So I am using everything as Kushagra user. So Kushagra user. @ your slave node IP address. So let me get my slave node IP address. So curl ifconfig.co. This is my slave node public IP address. Okay. So last, do you want to continue? Say yes. You have to give the password of Kushagra user which you gave in the slave node. Okay, so I'm going to type it here. Now you see a trust got established between your public and your private key server. Okay, slave node. So you can write a shell script for that. Obviously, you can automate. See Muthu Kumar, you have to first pro-configure Ansible. To configure Ansible, you cannot use Ansible. Okay, you have to write a way or you can write a script to do this task. Now, guys, I told you we have a host file. So default location is cd/etc ansible. If you go inside etc ansible, guys, you see we have a file called host. Let's go inside the host file. let's make a group. You give any name of your choice. Let's say I make a group with the name test, and inside this test group, I will give the IP address of my slave node. Okay, where which I have configured right now to apply configuration. Let's save it. Now, guys, see the beauty of. I'm not logged in sudo user. One second, sudo. So, guys, one more thing I need to do is. There's one more step I need to do. Every time it will ask for password, in order to get rid of that scenario, I will add this user in the sudoers file. One second, let me don't work. Exit. So go to this location vihc sudoers. Go at the bottom. This is just to make sure never ask for password again and again. And add this line. Username, that is Kushagra in my scenario, space all equals to no password colon space all. This is, guys, what we are doing is we are giving the sudoers file Kushagra user has root permission, so that every time we run this user, it don't ask for password. Otherwise, every time ask for password. I don't want that to happen. That's why I'm running this particular command. Okay, let's save it. And let's restart the SSH service. It's up to you. If you guys are okay giving password, you can do this approach. Since I am not okay to give password every time, that's why I'm doing this. Same thing I will do on the slave. Vi slash etc slash sudoers. Kushagra space all. Equals to space. Let's save this and let's restart the service. Service SSHD restart. Again, I will switch user to Kushagra since I just did this just to show you guys this thing. Now let's go back to this file again. Sudo vi hc ansible hosts. Let's add it again now. Give any group name of your choice. I'm giving test. You can do whatever group name you want and the IP address, and let's save it out. Now, guys, see, we'll use some very, very basic commands in Ansible to do our task. So, guys, please pay attention. Okay. So let's say I told you when we install Ansible, some modules gets installed, right? Some default module. What are the modules that comes by default with Ansible installation? How to find it? Use the command Ansible. Just run Ansible. Okay. You will see that you have certain options available to use Ansible. That means your Ansible is installed. Now use the command Ansible dash dash version. So this will tell you what version of Ansible you are running. Where is your configuration file present? What version of Python it is using? All those details you can find with this command. Now let's say you want to find out what all modules comes as part of Ansible installation. You can simply use the command Ansible dash doc, I think dash L. So you can see these many modules comes installed by default as part of Ansible installation. Okay, so if you want to find the exact number, I think it's 2000 something. I don't remember the exactly. Around 2834 modules comes installed as part of Ansible installation. Now let's play with some of the modules. I want to check the slave node link to this master. Is it up or not? Okay, simple ping monitoring. How do I do that? I will use simple Ansible dash M. I'll call the module ping module. Okay, and my web server name group, which I gave as test. Press enter. You see, it is successfully able to ping my slave node and it is showing it's pingable. Now, guys, let's say I want to find uptime. How long this node is up? So for that, I'm going to use a module called command module. Okay, with every module, we have got certain thing called dash A, which means module argument. So here I want to find the uptime. So I will give an argument called uptime. And then, sorry, I gave spelling mistake. Uptime. So guys, you see this particular host is up from 13 minutes only. Just now we created. Now you, when you are saying, when we are doing ping, something we are getting, how in the backend it happening? If you want to find the module details, you can use the command ansible dash doc and ping. So see, you will find what actually this module is doing. For example, what Python library it is calling, what command it's executing, all those things you can find detail about any module by using this particular command. So guys, clear so far? Anyone, any doubts, any questions? Deepthi, you can write a script for that. See, you need to copy the keys. There is no alternate way. Okay, you, how will you establish a trust? It's a one-time job. You have to do it. You can either write, do it manually, or you can write a script for it. It's completely up to you. Or as part of a server build process, you can get this config. There is a way, but it cannot be done on the existing infrastructure. Any new server that got config provisioned infrastructure, you can have that key shared to the server while it's getting built or created. What is ASK commands? I don't get Muthu Kumar. When you say ASK commands, what do you mean by that? What is ASK? Can't we use Ansible ad hoc commands with ad hoc password? No, Ansible, it were no Muthu Kumar, it does not work like this. It is a public private key. That is how the tool is designed. So guys, let's take one more scenario. Let's say I want to install a software on my slave node. Let's say I want to install HTTPD, very basic. Okay, so how we use is Ansible dash AM. Let's call the YAM module, see anything we install. Then again, we give argument dash A, argument for our module argument dash A we use. Give the name of your module, name equals to HTTPD and state equals to present. Okay, where you want to deploy to test. See guys, whenever you want to deploy something, you need admin privileges. So we'll use something called dash B. That means you want to install as admin rights. So now if I go on my slave nodes and run the command rpm minus qa pipe grip httpd, see httpd got installed. Now let's see service status. Service httpd status. So service is not running. Same times I want to start the service also. Okay, let's take for same scenario. So what I will do here is I will call a module named service, give the name of service httpd and state equals to started. So this what we'll do is we'll start the service on my slave node. So now if I go back here, it is running. So guys, typical example of different tasks we can execute on slave node. Naveen, see, when we are copying on slave nodes, ask for password to authenticate. Remember, when I did copying, it asked me for a password. So you need to give password to authenticate. then only to allow it to copy it. Otherwise, anyone can come and copy their keys on the node. You need to give the password. Clear, Naveen? Clear, everyone? So guys, typical example of how things can be used using Ansible. You can make your things more complex, like you write a playbook where you can combine multiple steps. So for example, here we did manual two steps. First step, deploying a software, second, starting a service. You can write one playbook where you can combine both the steps as a one common playbook. You have all those options. So with Ansible, guys, believe me, there's not even a single scenario I have found till date which cannot be done using Ansible. Ansible is such an awesome tool which can make life so easy, whether you are a developer or you are an admin or you are a Unix or Windows admin, whatever you are, Ansible is for everyone. Because see, whatever application you are developing or coding or managing, you need infra for that. You need to both manage infra, configure infra, support infra. All those things can be automated using Ansible as the configuration management tool. Now, what actually it takes to become a DevOps engineer? What skills you need to become a DevOps engineer? So Ansible is a part of configuration management tool, but of the process of becoming of a DevOps pipeline. So what actually skill sets are needed in the market which people talk as of today for DevOps? So guys, we have pasted here some of the job openings which is from different companies like Honeywell. So see, to become a DevOps engineer, a knowledge of a programming language, like it can be PowerShell, Bash, Python. You need to have knowledge about CI/CD implementation. Okay, that is a pipeline implementation. How pipeline works, how pipelines provisioned, how pipelines can be orchestrated, how pipeline can be automated, all those things. You need to have knowledge on a version control system tool like Git, GitHub, and all those things, and knowledge on a cloud provision. So typical what companies are looking if you're trying to sell yourself a DevOps engineer. Same way, guys, if I'm looking for Headspace, another famous company, first requirement they have is knowledge on Linux, the basic operating system, knowledge on a version control system tool like Git. You need to have knowledge on infrastructure configuration management tool like Ansible. Okay, you need to have knowledge on CI tool like Jenkins and knowledge on some cloud platform. So typically what skill set people are looking here if you want to get yourself enrolled as a DevOps engineer. So guys, see another job description, what they're looking for. They're looking for infrastructure as a code. That means they're looking for people who knows Ansible. They're looking for people understanding of Linux, people who know CI/CD, people who know cloud experience. So these are typical skill sets which people are looking in the market for getting hiring someone with DevOps skill set. So guys, if you guys want to learn DevOps, all these skill set tools and technology, we have courses where we can help you with. We have weekend courses where we'll teach you guys from scratch what is DevOps, different version control system tools, CI tools, Jenkins, build tool, Maven. Here we'll do both the configuration management tool, Puppet and Ansible. We'll teach you guys how to containerize your application in Docker, Kubernetes. Same time, we'll teach you how to have continuous monitoring and we'll give you a brief walk overview on DevOps on cloud. So we have got courses which have 12 modules. As part of these courses will give you real time projects to work on and to learn on. So if anyone is interested to upscale themselves to learn DevOps so that they can scale their career, please, we'll be more than happy to help you with. So please feel free to reach out to us and we'll be happy to help you to upscale yourself and learn the latest DevOps technology. So this is a course curriculum, guys. The first, it is for 12 modules. The first module is introduction to DevOps, as I mentioned. Second module talks about Git, the version control system tool. Third module talks about Jenkins. Jenkins is a continuous integration tool. Then fourth module, it talks about Selenium. It's a testing tool. Fifth, we talk about Docker for containerization. Then we talk about Docker Swarm, Docker ecosystem for things like container orchestration. Then in the seventh module, we talk about Puppet, Ansible. These are configuration management tool. Then Kubernetes, again, a container orchestration tool. Nagios for monitoring. And finally, AWS Cloud. How to use DevOps with AWS Cloud. So this is the basic course content which we'll be covering as part of this particular course curriculum. So some of the features of our course, guys, all our courses are instructor based. Okay, it's not a recorded session. You'll have a live instructor teaching you and clearing your doubts. You will have 24/7 access support even after your course completes. So anytime you get stuck up any doubts, any queries, you can reach out support team and they'll be more than happy to help you. You have lifetime access to recordings, so any class that happens get recorded, and you have lifetime access to view in the portal all the study materials and the recording. as part of the course, you need to complete industry-based project so that you get a live exposure on how actually things are used and implemented. And if you are successfully submitting the project, you get a certification from Edureka that you're DevOps certified engineer. So guys, this was in brief about the different key components which we have for our DevOps course. Guys, any doubts, any questions? Anyone in the class, any questions, any doubts on Ansible or DevOps or this particular course overall? Ravi, you have to practice and you need a good person to teach you to understand, learn it. If you want any help, reach out to us and we'll be more than happy to help you with that. So Ravi, you can go to Edureka's website, simpleedureka.co. Okay, and here you can click on DevOps. And here you can find the different DevOps courses that we have. Okay, and you can find more details like DevOps certification course, Docker, AWS certified DevOps, or whatever course you want to enroll. You can just give you more details on this. You can see we have timings of weekday, weekend batch, whatever it is. So accordingly, you can find it. And as per your requirement, you can, otherwise you can contact Edureka support and they will be able to help you with this. So Prasad, you have got plugins where you can integrate Ansible with Jenkins. Oh, sorry, by mistake, the screen sharing got paused. I'm sorry, Ravi. So Ravi, as you can see, I went to edureka.co and inside that in top, you will only see DevOps. Click on DevOps, go to all courses. I'm so sorry, I was not doing, my screen got paused. Okay, click on DevOps here. Okay, then you can see all the DevOps course we have. So if you want to involve in the master's program or certification training, just click on that. And you can find then all the details about this course, what will be covered, what's curriculum it is, what's course content, timing, all those things. You can find detail about this particular course. Guys, any other doubts, any other questions? So if no questions, then thank you guys for Edureka provide DevOps and AWS YouTube playlist. Can I be industry ready if I go through DevOps and AWS playlist? Ravi, see, these playlists are designed to give you an overall walkthrough. But if you want to learn in deep, you need to get enrolled with us. See, we're just talking about some basic highlights in this playlist or in these videos. But if you want to learn deep dive and learn more and more, you better like get in touch with us and we'll be more than happy to help you upskill yourself. So thank you guys for joining this webinar.
I hope I was able to give you guys a brief overview of Ansible. What is Ansible? How it is configured? How it is provisioned? Yes, Ravi, go ahead with your question, please. What is RPA, Ravi? I've never heard this term before. What do you mean by RPA? Thank you, Deepti. Robotic. Both are different line, Ravi. So it depends on you what you goes with. When you talk about RPA, you go with things like AI ML. With DevOps, you talk about things like CI/CD. So it depends up to you which side you want to choose your career. Both are very hot technology in the market and too much in demand. So it's up to you which one you want to choose. Thank you, Sadesh. Thank you so much. So guys, thanks again for joining this session. I know for some persons in India, it's very early in the morning. And for people in US, it's late in the evening. So thanks again for joining this session. I hope I was able to clear some of your doubts in Ansible. If anyone want to learn more about this configuration management tool, please feel free to reach out to us. And we'll be more than happy to help you to upscale your skill sets. So thanks again, guys. Have a great day. And for people in the West Coast or the US, good night. Thank you, everyone.